Good morning. Welcome to Zionsville Christian Church. I hear that it's Father's Day. So, you know, I don't know how, but somehow or another over the course of the last few generations, Mother's Day and Father's Day have become liturgical holidays. But I am so glad that you're here on this day when we remember those male figures in our lives and those who've played male roles within our lives as they have loved us into being. And so we'll love each other into being this morning as we worship together. So there will be, I think, a call to worship on the screen. And join along with Paulette and the ensemble, and let us be called into worship.
Strength is standing in solidarity with the powerless.
Strength is turning.
morning.
Good morning.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there this morning. I would like to open with Psalm chapter 100, verses 4 through 5. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before God's presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord is God. It is God that hath made us, not we ourselves. We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture. Enter into the Lord's gates with thanksgiving and into God's courts with praise. Be thankful unto God and bless God's name. For the Lord is good. God's mercy is everlasting, and God's truth endureth to all generations. Please join me in prayer. God, we thank you this morning for who you are. We thank you for another day to gather in your presence. We thank you that you are an everlasting God, a healing God, and a merciful God. Thank you, God, for keeping us and allowing us to make it through another week. And thank you, God, that you have allowed us to enter into your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise one more time. All these things we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me now in the prayers of the people. God of mercy and healing, you who hear the cries of those in need, receive these petitions of your people, that all who are troubled may know peace, comfort, and courage. I'm going to read a name on our church's prayer list, and I ask that you will respond with, Lord, hear our prayer. The Thompson family.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Israel, Palestine.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Greg Bryan family, the Archer family.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bill White.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Tyler Ray and family.
Lord, hear our prayer.
David Wiseman.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lena Heckman.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Indianapolis and all victims of gun violence.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The family of Dante Wright.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Minneapolis and Brooklyn Center.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Janet Wilson.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Julia Prothro.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Carol Snyder.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Karen Walkendorf.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Marilyn Luther.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Millie Gardner and Leslie Gardner.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The Chisholm family.
Lord, hear our prayer.
All individuals COVID positive and individuals quarantined.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Medical professionals.
Lord,
students, families, administrators, and staff back to school in the COVID-19 era.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Becky Nunnally.
Lord, hear our prayer.
All who are homebound and shut in.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Local, state, and federal leaders.
Lord, hear our prayer.
ZCC leaders.
Lord, hear our prayer.
All who are experiencing poverty. Justice seekers and workers.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Victims and families of victims of racism and violence.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord God, friend of those in need, your Son Jesus has untied our burdens and healed our spirits. We lift up the prayers of our hearts for those who are still burdened, those seeking healing, and those in need within the church and the world. Amen.
On that day, when evening had come, he said to them,
I will bless the Lord at all times. God's praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, let us magnify God's holy name. Let us praise God together. Taste and see that the Lord is good. And let everything that has breath, and that includes you, praise the Lord. Mason, there should be a graphic for the screen. That is not it. I don't know how that got there. It is a picture of a hill. The hill that I might just die on. Do you see it in front of presenter? On the right hand side? Maybe? It's the importance of song and of music, the importance of art and worship is that sometimes pictures can say things and express things and in ways in which words cannot. But let us pray together. God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing in your sight. God, you are without a doubt our rock and our redeemer. Help us to measure our steps. Help us to gauge hills, and help us, strengthen us with courage and with faith that there may in fact be hills upon worth dying. Amen. Tyler, are paint colors really worth risking your relationship over? Let me explain. It was about a month before Amanda and I got married. We were getting the house ready for her to move in, getting ready to move this house from a bachelor pad to double occupancy. And the marriage almost ended before it had even begun, because I'm sure none of you would think this about me, but I haven't always picked my battles wisely. I haven't always gauged which hills were appropriate to die on. Yes, the dreaded not picking your battles wisely over paint colors. Wisdom, I'm learning, is about deciding which hills are worth dying upon. Kitchen, living room, bedroom paint colors. Are you willing to die on the paint color hill? It all seems pretty silly at this point. There are enough battles that we face every day. And then author and entrepreneur Nick Haralambos notes that we fight every day. We fight for our lives. We fight to live. We fight to get our way. We fight for our relationships. We fight at work. Every day, there are plenty of hills that stand in our way in which we find ourselves posed to do battle. Friends, the issue is not so much that we fight a lot, it's that most of us don't realize we're fighting and that don't know which hills we have climbed are important enough to die upon. I remember my middle school years. If a youngster had not been wearing a big dog t-shirt, the second favorite logo was one with the words inscribed, "No fear." No fear. And it's interesting to me, anyhow, that we have moved from, within my 39 years of life, that we have moved from a place where people proudly said that they had no fear, even wore it upon their sleeves, to being a culture and a society in which we seem to be fearing everyone and everything. Fear and faith, the issues that Jesus brings up. How afraid was Jesus? Well, not afraid enough. There's something to say about us living in a society in which everyone is expected to be afraid. Be afraid, be very afraid. If you're not as freaked out and afraid of X, Y, or Z person, or X, Y, and Z circumstance, if you're not as freaked out and afraid as me, then there must be something wrong with you. And what's wrong with you, Jesus? I mean, after all, you dragged us out here in the middle of a lake in a boat, and here you are sleeping, Jesus. What's the matter with you? Things are getting tough. And when the tough get going, the going get tough. Jesus, what's wrong with you? Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith? Jesus' question trumps the disciples' earlier harsh assessment of his sleeping. What's wrong with you, Jesus? Jesus is asleep because he had complete and full trust in God. Jesus identified the disciples' fearful response as there being a lack of faith. If you are afraid, then you must not have enough faith. Now, the congregations which Mark is writing, a predominantly Jewish congregation, doesn't record the question in verse 40 to excoriate the congregation, but to urge them to learn from the disciples' negative examples. Mark wants his readers around the year 70 to have a faith that breeds confident witness, even in the face of situations that could cause panic and alarm. Friends, there is no doubt that the waters of chaos within social life threaten to overwhelm our ships. It's the beautiful part of being a pastor to so many different types of individuals from so many different types of circumstances and contexts to learn what it is, what storms rage and what chaos stirs that threatens to lap over the ship. And perhaps more beautiful than living into the chaos with you into being a true community, of course, we engage and help bail one another's boats, don't we? But perhaps more beautiful than sitting in the chaos and the storms of one another's personal and collective lives. One other thing is so beautiful about that. In verse 41 that Paulette read for us, the disciples were filled with great awe. When Jesus wakes up and decides to not exercise the same amount of fear as the disciples, but when he simply sits with them, he doesn't tell them you have nothing to worry about. What are you? He sits and he listens. And awe came upon him. Who is this guy that sleeps amidst the fear? We all have known people who seemingly are willing to die upon every hill that they see. I've been that person. And undoubtedly, this sort of renegade thought where nothing seems to matter except for our willingness to die. Friends, we often fear people or think people are just downright crazy when we meet people who are unafraid of dangerous situations. What's the matter with you, Jesus? Be afraid, be very afraid, and there isn't an ounce of fear. That person must have a screw loose. An absolute trust in God is disconcerting. especially when that trust is exhibited at a time and place when death is a very real possibility. When death is a real possibility and you are sleeping, what's the matter with you, Jesus? Not to fear death is unusual, unless, of course, you've found a cause in life that is greater than the fear of death. On this Juneteenth weekend, I'm reminded of the ancestors who have come before Minister Alexis, the ancestors like Martin Luther King Jr., who affirmed that the cause of justice was more powerful than the fear of death. He noted that in his last sermon in Memphis in April of 1968. Rooted in the Baptist tradition, nurtured and bathed along with Jesus in his baptism, Dr. King was rooted deeply within Jesus when he reaffirmed his faith by being obedient to God, even to the point of death. What do you see when you see someone who has chutzpah? A person who is seemingly unafraid of dangerous situations. Where did they get that confidence and that courage? God, of course. This is a question for us today. What shall we do with our courage? Do we lack courage? What is it that you are afraid of? Now, I ask because I have a hunch that we're really rarely aware of just how significant a role fear plays in many of our decisions. Our actions, our conversations. Well, if I do that, I might lose this. Focusing so much on what we're afraid to lose rather than what we might actually gain. What hills of justice do you need courage to fight? What hills are you willing to die upon? How does your faith spring into action as we learn to live courageously and to live in confidence that, friends, there are hills worth dying upon? Since I've already made a couple of cultural illustrations of my childhood, what's but one more? Whitaker has recently been asking, and since we're going through some chaotic waters ourselves, and Dad is trying to muster up some courage, he's been asking for certain things in which Mom and Dad right now really can't say no to. Hey, you know those ice cream bars? They're square. Grandpops had them. You never let us eat. You know, of course, he's eight, so he's got to jab us while he's at it. You know those things grandpops have in their house that you won't ever let us get? How about we get some sure, bud? Whatever you need. What's the matter with you, Dad? Of course, Whitaker is talking about the Klondike bar. Do you all remember that commercial? I'm not going to sing it, but what would you do? Well, I lied. Apparently, you can't say it without singing it. Try it. No, well, some of you might try it. What would you do for a Klondike bar? Do you remember that? we must pick which hills we're willing to die on and do so carefully and discerning. To live more faithfully into who God has already called us to be. Lest we end up doing more for a Klondike bar than we're willing to do for Jesus. Faith and courage, confidence and faith, staying awake amidst the storm, taking the beating of the chaos and resting in that gracious and grateful assurance. It calls us from time to time to the other side. What would you do? What will we do, friends? What risks are we willing to take? Let us consider prayerfully all the hills that we might be willing to die upon. I hear there's a hill in which we might just find Jesus.
Join me in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, on this day when we celebrate fathers, may we also celebrate the gift that you are to all humankind. We have come to rely on your strength and peace in times of turmoil, disease, sorrow, and unrest, and also upon the words of your Son, Jesus, to keep us keeping on. We thank you always for your love and strength and for the life of your Son, the Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The cost-benefit analysis, when given following the footsteps of Jesus, seems dire, doesn't it? From time to time, I'll flip through local, we have an antenna, and I'm just interested to see what is coming through on the Indianapolis area airwaves. And I saw, no offense, I typically am not a huge fan of Southern gospel quartets. But something caught my ear. I heard this wonderful gospel quartet singing a song, and it went something like this. He never promised that the road would not get weary, but help would always come in time. And then, to liven up the crowd, They sang an oldie but a goodie. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. Knowing and weighing the risk, weighing the costs, and coming to this table and experiencing Jesus anew as he speaks into us, as he lives in us and through us. We're told yet again through the gift of grace that, in fact, help always comes in time. And that following Jesus, even if it means being staked up on a hill, that it's worth it. Let me put it more succinctly. When we come to the table, we acknowledge that to be a follower of Jesus means we may end up on a cross, so we best look good on wood. For he was broken for the brokenness of the world, and he poured out hope for the hopeless. On the night before Jesus showed him his full extent of his love, having weighed the cost and deciding it was all worth it, yes, you and I, this world, were worth it. He blessed the bread and broke it, and he gave it to them, and he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he gave thanks for the cup. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and drink, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sin. Drink of it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat of the bread and drink of the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And it's in his love and his grace that he reminds us each and all that, yes, we can do this hard thing. Amen. Thank you. God knows we're willing to die on stupid hills. The slides not being perfect is not a hill I'm willing to die on this morning. How about you? God knows there are enough things that beckon our attention, beckon my. Hills. So let us continue to do that. Let us continue to love one another because God has loved us first. Friends, go in peace. Let us be strengthened and nurtured by the Spirit which beckons us, calls us to God's work.
Thank you.